Welcome, dear listeners, to the Carolina Haynes Podcast, brought to you by Wreak Havoc Productions and A Darker World. I'm your host, Dan Sellers. As an art form, music is magic. Like other art forms, it elicits a wide variety of emotions within us. We listen to music to cheer us up when we're down. We listen to pump us up when we go to the gym. We listen at work to make the day go by faster. Music gives us life. And sometimes, we can give life back to music. There are certain stories that would have been lost to history long, long ago if they hadn't been immortalized in song. I'm talking about murder ballads. Murder ballads can be about either fictional murders or based on actual people. We're going to take a look at a couple of murder ballads based on actual events and how the magic of music can skew our perception of reality, confusing song lyrics for facts. You may remember from episode 9 of season 2 of this show, a popular murder ballad of the 1930s about the Lawson family murders by the Carolina Buddies.
His name was Charlie Lawson, and he had a loving wife, but the name
But in this episode, we're going to focus on three other famous songs with North Carolina connections. Take, for instance, the song Frankie and Johnny. It tells the story of Frankie, who was executed in the electric chair for shooting her boyfriend Johnny after catching him having sex with Nellie Bly. Supposedly, this is based on the story of Frank Baker, a young African-American prostitute from Oregon, around the turn of the century. The Johnny in Frankie Baker's story is actually named Albert Britt, her 17-year-old pimp, and the girl he had caught having sex with was named Alice Pryor. Frankie was arrested, but claimed that Britt came at her with a knife, and she only added in self-defense. The jury believed her and set her free.
You're gonna miss me, huh, in the days to come.
The only thing factual about Frankie Baker's story in regard to the song is that her name was actually Frankie and that she shot someone. There is, however, a story of another Frankie that is also similar to the song's tale. In reality, the song is most likely the combination of both stories. Frankie Stewart Silver lived in Morganton, North Carolina, with her husband and 13-month-old daughter. Her husband's name was Charlie, but everyone called him Johnny. On December 22, 1831, Frankie Silver murdered her husband with an axe. But she didn't stop when he was dead. She kept chopping and chopping until his body lay in pieces on their cabin floor. She burned his remains in the fireplace, then slipped into his boots and walked away from the cabin. When the police arrived, she claimed that Johnny had just walked out on them. But when they looked around, the police found the fireplace full of oily ashes, along with pieces of bone and chunks of charred flesh. The exact motive of the murder has been lost to time, but court records allude to domestic violence and or an extramarital affair. Frankie Silver was found guilty and hung to death. Frankie and Johnny, the song, has been recorded by over 250 artists, including Elvis Presley.
Frankie and me, we are lovers.
Johnny Cash.
He was a long-legged guitar picker with a wicked wandering eye, but he was her man nearly all of the time.
And Sam Cooke.
At least that's the way the story goes. Frankie bought everything for Johnny, from his sports car to his Ivy League clothes. Oh, he was a man, all right. Oh, but he was doing a wrong.
Just to show you. Presley actually made a movie based on the story. At least four other Frankie and Johnny movies have been made, all of them based off the song lyrics rather than the actual story.
In his Jaguar with a chick named Nellie Bly. Oh, and if he was your man, honey, let me tell you, he was doing you wrong. Let me tell the story. Frankie ran
another song, Poor Ellen Smith, tells the story of a girl found shot to death and the man who spent the rest of his life behind bars proclaiming his innocence.
Her clothes were all scattered and thrown on the ground. The blood marked the spot where poor Ellen was found.
The real story of Ellen Smith was a much darker tale. In 1892, the body of Ellen Smith was found in the woods behind the Zinzendorf Hotel in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Peter DeGraff was a ruffian with a long criminal history. One evening, Peter found an easy mark in 17-year-old Ellen Smith. He convinced her to have sex with him. In life, Ellen was a lovely young woman, but suffered from a slight mental handicap. She didn't understand the concept of a one-night stand, and was confused as to why her new boyfriend was seeing other women. Their time together had resulted in Ellen's pregnancy, but the child died at birth. After losing the baby, Ellen started following DeGraff around, begging for her boyfriend to marry her. This undoubtedly hampered Peter's ability to score with other women. Finally, he sent her a note telling her to meet him in the woods behind the hotel where they both worked. When she got there, he shot her through the heart at close range. It didn't take long for the police to tie Ellen Smith to Peter DeGraff and quickly issued a warrant for his arrest. They did not, however, act on carrying out that warrant. Peter DeGraff strutted around town and taunted the police. The newspaper speculated that DeGraff had some dirt on the Forsyth County Sheriff. And in fact, it wasn't until a new sheriff was elected 2 years later that DeGraff was finally arrested. DeGraff was charged with first-degree murder, and he pled not guilty at his trial. He was convicted and sentenced to hang. Public opinion was that DeGraff was innocent. Over 6,000 people showed up to his execution, many protesting for his release. The crowd fell silent when, with the noose around his neck, he asked to make a final statement.
I killed Ellen Smith. The only words she said after I shot her were, "Lord, have mercy on me." I stand here today to receive my just reward. I again say to the people here, beware of bad women and whiskey. Don't put your hands on cards, bad women and dice. Hear my dying words.
Who had the heart and who had the brain to shoot my little darling on this cold, lonesome plain? They picked up their rifles and hunted us down. They found us all.
And then there's perhaps the most famous and most misrepresented murder ballad, that of Tom Dooley.
Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, hang down your head and cry. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley, poor boy, you're bound to die.
His real name was Tom Dula, but the local pronunciation was Dooley. Confusing the story further, was Dooley's military record. Hailed as a song that sold 10,000 guitars, Tom Dooley tells the story of Dooley who kills his girlfriend, Laura Foster. It also tells of the man who brought him to justice, Colonel James Grayson, who was another one of Laura's suitors.
This time tomorrow.
Tom grew up in Wilkes County, North Carolina. Three of his childhood friends were cousins, Anne, Laura, and Pauline Foster. Then one day, Anne's mother found him in bed with her daughter. She was just 14 years old. But hell, Tom was only 12. Later, Anne married James Milton, and Tom ended up living with them too. Now, I'd say at this point, Anne and Tom began having an affair, but that would imply that the husband didn't know about it. James Milton not only knew that Anne and Tom were sleeping together, he encouraged it. James Milton slept alone. A couple of years later, on Tom's 18th birthday, both he and James Milton joined the 42nd North Carolina Infantry Regiment. Contrary to many tales of Dooley's military service, he did not make it through the war unscathed. He was wounded in battle many times, and both he and James were captured and held until 1865 when the war ended. After the war, the men came back to find that Pauline Foster, Anne's cousin, was also living in the house as a housekeeper. It didn't take long before both Anne and Pauline were sharing Tom Dooley's bed, and James Milton was still sleeping alone.
Poor boy, you're bound to die.
Poor boy, you're bound to die.
A few months later, and to further complicate matters, Tom began having an affair with Laura Foster, Anne and Pauline's other cousin. His relations with Laura were not known to the other women, or so he thought. But Anne knew about Laura and was extremely jealous. Then, Tom contracted syphilis. He assumed that Laura, the newcomer, had given it to him, but later, during the trial, the local doctor would testify that the first person he had treated for the disease was Pauline. But regardless, now all four of them had it, and Tom vowed revenge on the one he thought guilty, Laura. On May 25th, 1866, Laura Foster's father woke to find that she had packed a bag, taken his horse, and left home. The horse returned the following day, but there was no sign of Laura. Her father searched for weeks and finally found the place where his horse had been tied to a tree. It was a spot not too far from James Milton's house. Foster also found a large bloodstain nearby. The police immediately suspected Tom, and he fled to Tennessee. Not long after that, Pauline also visited him in Tennessee, and when she returned, a friend joked with her, asking if she had gone to Tennessee because she killed Laura. Well, Pauline joked back saying, sure, she and Tom had killed Laura together. A bystander overheard them talking, and soon Pauline was arrested as an accessory to Laura's murder. Pauline told the police that it was really Tom and Anne who had killed Laura. She said that Anne had once shown her where Laura was buried. Pauline led them to Laura's shallow grave in the woods. They discovered that she had been stabbed through the heart. The grave had been dug too small, and Laura's legs had been broken to make her fit in the hole. The police learned that Tom was working on the farm of Colonel James Grayson in Tennessee. Grayson convinced Dooley to turn himself in and escorted him back to Wilkes County. The song suggests that Grayson was also a suitor of Laura Foster, but there is no evidence to suggest that, or that he even knew Tom or Laura before the murder. Surprisingly, former Governor Zebulon Vance volunteered to defend Dooley free of charge. This led some people to believe that Dooley had served for Colonel Vance during the war, but he hadn't. Ann Milton was found not guilty, but Tom Dooley was sentenced to death. On May 1st, 1868, he was hanged in Statesville. There are many legends and myths that surround Tom Dooley, including the claim that he wrote the lyrics to his ballad himself, or that he sat atop his own coffin, playing the banjo on the way to the gallows, or that upon seeing his noose proclaimed that, quote, "I would have washed my neck if I had known you were using such a nice clean new rope," end quote. None of this seems to be true, though. Tom Dooley, the song, is credited to Thomas Land as the author, and the most well-known version was performed by the Kinston Trio in the 1950s. A movie was made about Tom Dooley in 1959, but it wasn't based on historical events, but rather the lyrics of the song. There's even a historical placard at the Lump Overlook on the Blue Ridge Parkway in Wilkes County. It was erected by the United States National Park Service. The text of the sign quotes the song lyrics and says very little about the historical facts of Dooley's life. Hang down your head, Tom Dooley. Poor boy, you're bound to die. This time tomorrow. This episode was researched and written by Jeffrey Cochran. It was narrated and produced by me, Dan Sellers. To find everything Jeff's up to, check out adarkerworld.com. To find everything that I'm up to, visit wreakhavocproductions.com. If you enjoyed this show, then leave us a review on iTunes or whatever platform you use to listen. Then do us another favor. Share it with your friends. Over this past season, we've seen the listenership of this show grow exponentially. So let's keep the trend going. Whether you simply share our page on our Facebook profile or share a link via text, everyone knows a friend who's into spooky stuff. Share this show to help us keep our audience growing. You can find the Caroline Hates podcast on iTunes, Google Play, YouTube, and as always, you can find every episode directly from carolinahaines.libsyn.com. That's LIBSYN.com. If you'd like to contribute to this show and all of our ongoing projects, you can find ways to help out through Patreon. That's patreon.com/wreakhavoc. I absolutely love it when listeners reach out and tell me what they think of the show. You can find us on Instagram at Wreak Havoc Productions, and I'm on Twitter at Hank vs. the Undead. And you can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/CarolinaHaints. And as always, you can email me your thoughts and suggestions at wreakhavocproductions@gmail.com. We'll be back in 2 weeks with another episode. Tune in then to hear more about the things that go bump in the night.